So this is EE610, lecture 8. Let me quickly show you all the common source amplifier configurations that we have seen. We started off by generating the bias voltage of the MOSFET using two resistors. RA, RB. Right? And then to this we connected, so this was your RL1. And you connected your small signal voltage source, which is the signal that you want to amplify, through a capacitor C1, which we said that has to be very, very large. We also connected the load using another capacitor as shown here. Then we realized biasing with a constant voltage at the gate is not a great idea. So we moved towards biasing with a constant current source. So what did we do to achieve this? We pushed a constant current IRF into the drain of a MOSFET. Does this guarantee that the current through the MOSFET is IRF? Yes, no. So if you just do this, there is no guarantee that the current through the MOSFET will, some ID will be equal to IRF. To do that, we have to generate the appropriate VGS. And we said that the same VGS can be generated by creating a negative feedback circuit like this. Right? You shorted the drain as well as the gate together. So if IRF was greater than ID, that meant that the drain potential here is going to increase, decrease. IRF is greater than ID. Drain potential will increase, right? Which means the gate voltage increases, VGS of the transistor increases, and the ID will increase till it catches up with IRF, right? So you could generate, so you could generate a bias voltage using this configuration, and then we fed this bias voltage to another transistor that was acting like our amplifier transistor, and you connected your small signal at this node using a capacitor. Any source will come with its own source resistance, so through an RS as shown here, and you took out your output again through another capacitor onto a load R. Then we said we don't want to use two transistors for bias generation as well as amplifying. So we simplified the circuit by using a single transistor. So you had an IRF flowing into this transistor. We of course had to connect the gate and drain together to ensure that a constant IRF was flowing as a bias current through this transistor. But we did not want this short circuit to be present in the incremental circuit, right? So we could replace this with an inductor. And then we connected our small signal circuit like this. Small signal voltage source as shown here. And your load was connected here. Then we said we don't want to use an inductor if we have an option. So what did we replace our inductor with? What did we replace our inductor with? With a large resistance. Okay. So I replaced this with a large resistance. You'll see that a resistor is our favorite substitute actor. Anytime we need to replace some component, because of any of the reasons, a resistor is the first component we'll try sending into that position. right? So you can see, we have now looked at four different circuits. So I'm showing you four different circuits on the screen here. And if you were looking at it for the first time, it looks like four different circuits as such, right? But now you know that underlying functionality of all these circuits is the same. They are all common source amplifiers, just different means of biasing them. And you also know the reason why every capacitor, every resistor has been added to the circuit, right? There is no need to guess. When you are doing circuit design, this is not gambling or intraday stock trading. You don't have to take chances. It's a very logical thought process, right? And you don't have to by heart any of these circuits. You know, within a span of 2 weeks, we have easily come up with four possible architectures. I can quickly replace maybe this RL1 with another inductor. What change does it cause? Let's say I replaced it with some inductor, very large inductor. In the bias circuit, what change does it cause? DC. So under DC conditions, what happens to the inductor? Short circuit, right? The drain to source voltage of this MOSFET will now be VDD instead of a different VDD minus IRF into R, right? So the drain to source voltage is VDD. What happens to the inductor in the incremental picture? If it's a very, very large inductor, then omega in L is going to be very large. Therefore, it is almost as if it's an open circuit, right? Just that your load resistor simply becomes RL instead of RL1 parallel R, right? So, given any of this circuit, I could easily replace one component with a slightly different component and you should still be able to analyze it, right? So, there is no need to by heart anything. If you try to by heart circuits, then you'll not finish by hearting circuits. There are so many possible configurations, right? So no guesses, no by hearting. It's a lot of logical thinking and a little bit of common sense. That is all that is required in circuit design. Okay, so for this particular circuit, I wanted to cover a small portion that I missed yesterday. How did the incremental circuit for this look like? Let's start from Vs. There is Rs. I'll assume that C1 has been designed to be large enough such that it is a short. Then you have Rx. If this node potential is Vg, the current through this transistor is now Gm times Vg. Good. And you have a resistor RL here. And then we also derived an equation for the gain from Vs to Vout. So let me bring up that equation. So anytime you make any derivation consisting of for a circuit, one of the first steps to do is to run some sort of sanity check on it. You have gotten a big equation, see if that equation is making sense to you, right? So, one of the easiest sanity checks to do is to check for its dimensions. What should be the dimension of the equation on RHS? It has to be dimensionless, right? Is that RHS dimensionless? It is, right? Right? So, dimensionally the equation is correct, right? The next thing you can do is, you look at the circuit in front of you, right? See if you can tend certain components to either zero or infinity and see what output it is going to give you, right? For example, in the circuit, let's say I make my RL to infinity. Oh, even easier. Let's say I make my RL to zero. What do you think will happen? If RL is zero, this is basically, right, it is grounded, which means that your V out is always going to be equal to zero, right? So I have now made my RL to zero, which means the GL tends to infinite. Now substitute GL equal to infinity in the given expression and tell me what happens. It goes to zero, right? This is a very quick check that you can do. So We put RL tending to 0 and we see that V out is equal to 0, both intuitively as well as from the equation. Now, another quick check that you could do. Would be to make your RS tend to infinity, right? Or your GS tend to 0. If RS tends to infinity, what happens here? This is open circuited, right? So here you will have some potential VS. What would be VG? VG is equal to V out, I agree. You said it is 0. Why is it 0? How can we? So, if I could have a current GMVG flowing through this, I could also have another current flowing through this. Right? So, is it obvious that V out has to be 0 given that I can have two currents here? So, I agree that no current can flow through RX. The current here has to be 0. No current can flow into the gate, which means you can't have any current flowing through RX. This is 0. Right? But I could have a finite VG such that some current exists through MOSFET and some current exists through the RL resistor. Right? So now we do we assume that V out is some positive value. I don't care what it is some positive value. If V out is positive, that means my VG is also positive. Right? If VG is positive, then the current is flowing in this direction. Right? GM times VG, VG is positive, so I have a current flowing like this. V out is positive, I will also have a current flowing like this through RL. Right? Is your KCL satisfied? No, right? So V out cannot be positive because it is leading to an inconsistent solution. Now let's assume that V out is negative. Right? If V out is negative, which means your gate voltage is negative, which means current is now flowing in the opposite direction through the transistor. Right? Again, V out is negative, which means through the resistor also the current has to flow like that, from higher potential to lower potential. KCL is again not satisfied. Therefore, the only possible solution is for V out to be equal to 0. Right? So, once you see few circuits like this, you will be able to look at it and say that V out is 0 for a circuit like this. So now you know that if you make your RS to infinity or GS to 0, you should get your V out to be 0. Right? That is just pure intuition looking at the circuit in front of you. Put the same value GS equal to 0 in the equation. Tell me, what do you get? Goes to 0, right? So the third sanity check we did is we made our RS go to infinity and we see that V out is consistently 0 volt in both the cases. Right? What is one more check that you can suggest? I make my RX tend to infinity. RX tending to infinity means this resistor is now not here, right? It is open circuit, right? What is your gain? It should simply be equal to minus GM times RL or should be equal to minus GM times GL. RX tending to infinity corresponds to GX tending to 0. Put GX equal to 0 here. What do you get? Minus GM by GL, right? So we put RX tending to infinity and you see that your V out is simply minus GM by GL into whatever is the input you have fed. Right? So anytime you derive a big or any equation, please see what sort of sanity check you can run on it. Right? Dimensions is always the first sanity check that you can easily run. On top of it, look at the circuit and see if you can tend any component to 0 or infinity such that, just by looking at it, you'll be able to guess what the answer is. Again, no guessing, just by looking at it, you'll be able to know what the answer is and apply the same condition to the equation you have derived. Okay. Any questions on this? Okay, now I would like to focus on this particular circuit configuration here. So we took a current IRF. Passed it through a transistor like this, right? And we know that some voltage VGS0 is generated. Now, if I connect this VGS0 to another transistor that has the same W by L as this transistor, so let me call this as M0. Let's say this has some W by L associated with M0. I make sure the W by L of this transistor is same as that of M0. Then what is the current flowing through this? This will be IRF. Right? Now I could connect this to one more transistor with the same W by L. What is the current flowing through it? This is also IRF. So I am able to copy the same current into multiple transistors. Right? Therefore, this configuration wherein you mirror the current in one branch into multiple other branches is called as, what should we call it? Current mirror. Okay. So you might have only one ideal current source with you. Using a current mirror, you can generate 50 or 100 copies or as many as required on your chip. Right? And once you understand this, you also understand that we can do very interesting stuff with this, right? For example, I could take two such transistors, both at the same W by L, and I short the drain of both. Then what is the current flowing through this? This will be twice of IRF, right? Now, instead of using W by L of M0 here, let's say I use twice of the W by L. Then how much is the current flowing through this?
2 IRF,
right? So this way I could make any multiplication. I could multiply the current by any factor and make copies of that. So this current mirroring is a very, very useful concept to know. Let me also focus a little bit on this architecture you see here, right? How many terminals does this, once I connect like this, how many terminals does it have? By one. Other one is connected to ground, right? So this is looking like a one port circuit. You could say that the other terminal is a ground terminal, but it is still a terminal, right? So it's two terminal device, right? But one port. How does its IV characteristic look like? This is a transistor. It has been biased in saturation, right? Once it is biased in, so till it reaches saturation, till the input here, VGS, reaches the threshold voltage, the current is zero. What happens after that? Then it follows a square law, right? The straight line resistor answer that you gave me is true for small signals. If I make a small fluctuation over this, then the small current drawn corresponding to that small fluctuation in VGS, those two are related as if this is a resistor, right? But otherwise, this is a relationship. And of course, this follows a square law relationship. Now, this architecture is called as diode connected transistor. Now, prior to before we moved on with MOSFETs, we used to use another type of transistor called as BJT, bipolar junction transistors. Now, in the bipolar junction transistor also, you could make a equivalent connection, a similar connection between the collector and the base. Now, once you make that connection, the BJT then acts like a PN junction diode. Its I versus V relationship was exponential in nature, like a diode. So therefore, we started calling that configuration as a diode connected transistor. We moved on with MOSFETs, which doesn't have the exponential relationship, but due to legacy reasons, we still call it a diode connected transistor. Okay. Now, in the incremental circuit, this becomes a resistor of value 1 by gm. So if I had so if these were the two terminals, I could replace it with 1 by gm. Okay. Now let us also consider what happens if you had a non-zero channel length modulation. This would mean that so how would the incremental picture then look like? So in the incremental picture, you would have, if this was some, if you had applied some VGS like this, right, the current flowing through this would be GM times VGS. On top of it, you also have a resistor of value RDS, right, or equal to 1 by GDS. So then how, what would be the equivalent circuit? It is parallel combination of this component plus this component, right? This portion we already know acts like a 1 by GM resistance, right? And you will have a current flowing through this given by VGS into GDS. Is that clear? It's parallel combination of 1 by GM and 1 by GDS. So the equivalent equivalent circuit again becomes a resistor of value 1 by GM plus GDS, right? If you have two resistances, okay, and I represent them using conductance, let's say G1 and G2, then what is equivalent resistance? Or what is equivalent conductance? This will be equal to G1 plus G2. It's the same thing. So resistor of value GM plus GDS, or the equivalent conductance of value GM plus GDS. Resistor of 1 by GM plus GDS and equivalent resistor conductance GM plus GDS. Is that clear? Okay. So now let me take a step back and revisit what we did for biasing the transistor with a constant current. So you had a transistor like this, right? You wanted to bias this with some constant current. What did we do? We sensed the current. We sensed and compared the current at, where did we sense the current? At the drain node, right? So we sensed the current at drain, and then we varied VGS. How did we vary VGS? By varying the gate node, right? So is this the only possible thing we can do? So we have to sense the current somewhere, find out if the current is larger or smaller than what we require. And then we have to go and vary something such that the current is adjusted to the value we require. So far we have been sensing at the drain, and then we were varying at the gate. Where else could you have sensed this current? We can sense the current at source also, because whatever is the current entering the drain, the same current is going to come out of the source, right? So instead of sensing and comparing at the drain, I could have done this operation at the source of the MOSFET. Similarly, to vary VGS, I could vary gate, I could vary source, or I could vary both, right? Typically, it is easier to keep one constant and vary the other. So now we will say that we can vary the gate or we can vary the source. The third option of varying both is also a reasonable solution, right? But since we are starting out, we will take it in small baby steps. So we have to either vary gate or vary source, okay? And what we have done so far is sense it at the drain, vary at the gate, and this was called as a drain feedback. Okay. Now, how many possible combinations are there? looking at this 4, right? I could sense a drain, then vary at gate or vary at source. Or I could sense at source and then vary at the drain, sorry, gate or vary at the source. Okay. So now let us consider a different possibility. Say I want to sense at the source and I want to vary the potential at the source. Okay. So since we are now going to sense and vary at the source, I know that my gate potential is a constant. So I will directly connect some voltage VG0 at the gate. Right? Now I need to sense at the drain. Sorry. Sense at the source. And I'm also going to vary at the source. Right? So for now, I'll simply connect my drain node to VDD. Right? Now, how do we sense or compare something at a terminal? We need to do this at this node. Right? And I want to make sure that a current IREF is flowing through this transistor. What should I do if I want to compare both? I have to figure out the difference in current. Let's assume that there is some current ID flowing through this. Right? What I need to observe is if the ID is greater than IREF or if my ID is lesser than IREF. Right? And how do we sense this? So if I want to sense something, right, I want, basically when I'm doing a comparison like this, I'm looking for the error. So I need to get the quantity ID minus IRS. How do I get ID minus IRS? I simply short this, then any difference in the current is going to flow out of this. That is okay. Right? Can you also tell me what happens to the source potential? Assume that ID is greater than IRF, which means the amount of current entering this node is larger than the amount of current leaving this node. And like I said, you can imagine that this excess current is flowing into some small capacitance at that node. Right? Some small capacitor at that node. What happens if an excess current flows into a capacitor? The charge potential is going to increase, right? Which means that you expect to see your source potential to increase. Okay. Now, if the ID is greater than IRF, what should happen to VGS? ID is greater, which means current is greater than what we need. That is happening because VGS is greater than what we need. What should happen to VGS? VGS should reduce. Right. The only control we have now is on the source potential. If I want to reduce VGS, what should I do to VS? We have to yank VS up, right? So we want VGS to reduce, right? VGS is given by some constant VG0 minus VS. I want to make VGS0 smaller, which means I have to increase my VS, right? So the action to do is increase your VS. Okay? What happens if ID is smaller than IRF? The current entering this node is smaller than the current leaving this node. That means a negative current is getting pushed into the capacitor, or a current is being pulled out of the capacitor. What happens to the capacitor potential? It decreases. So your VS is now going to? VS is decreasing, correct? Now all of this is happening because your ID is smaller than IRS. Right, which means you want to increase your ID. To increase your ID, what should you do to VGS?
Increase
VGS. What should you do to the source potential?
Decrease.
Right. So you now need to decrease VGS. Now tell me what connection I should make to ensure that this is a negative feedback. It is already a negative feedback. Can you see that? This is happening because you are sensing as well as trying to feedback the information at the same node. Just the act of connecting the current source here has ensured that the current through the drain, current through the transistor is equal to IRF. Are you able to appreciate the elegance of this circuit? It looks like we have simply connected an IRF there, but the act of connecting the IRF has introduced a negative feedback, which is adjusting the gate source potential to ensure that the current through the transistor is IRF. The circuit is a very humble looking guy, but it's actually a very good negative feedback that is in action here. Okay, and the key takeaway I want you to, you know, take out of this class is, if you are able to verbalize and think logically about a problem, implementing it on the circuit is the easy part. The hard part is figuring out what is the sort of relationship you want, what is the sort of algorithm you want that needs to be implemented. Once you know that, implementing it on the circuit is the easy part. Okay, so we have now biased our circuit. We have figured out how to do the biasing. So if I apply VG0 here and I give a current IREF here, what comment can you make about the potential at the source of the transistor? So under steady state, let's assume that it has settled to some VS0. What would be the value of the source potential? What is the value of VGS0? VTH plus root of 2ID by mu and COXWY. This is something that you know. So if you know VG0 and if you know VGS0, can you calculate VS0? Right? So tell me the expression. This will be VG0 minus VTH. So this is VG0 minus VGS0, which is VG0 minus VTH minus square root of 2ID by mu and COXWY. Okay? Right. So we have figured out biasing. What is the next step to do? Figure out how to get an amplification out of this, right? So this is a circuit we have. What we finally want is that in the operating point calculations, in the large signal picture, it has to look like this. And in the small signal picture, we want to connect VS. This always comes with its own source resistance. And we want to connect this to some load resistor R. Right? And again, we are okay even if there is an additional component here. We'll simply make sure that whatever this resistance is, our RS is much, much larger than this resistance. Sorry, RS is much, much smaller than this resistance. And we are okay even if something comes in parallel with this. So now let's try and connect our small signal source into the circuit. So we have some VDD. This is IREF. Now I need to connect a battery of value VG0 here. Given that I am already using one battery, it doesn't make sense for me to go and buy another battery. I'll simply use a resistor divider and then generate VG0. Right? So I use this, I will get a constant potential here. Is that a problem? It's not a problem, right? Because VG0 will remain constant. Your source voltage is going to adjust itself such that the current remains constant. Right? So I am okay with VG0 being a constant. Now let's say I connect my small signal source through a capacitor C1. This is RS. This is VS. And I connect my output at this node through a capacitor C2. Right? Is this node fine now? Or do you see a problem here? This node. Let's look at the output node first, the drain of the MOSFET. Is that fine? Why is it not fine? It is always VDD, right? Which means in the incremental picture, it is always ground, right? This node has been connected to a battery of VDD. When you are looking at the incremental picture, that battery is assigned a zero value, So this is always ground. So what correction should I make? I'll have to add another resistance here. So let's say I added some RL1 and I made this connection. Is my circuit fine now? Okay. Then let me look at this circuit and sketch its incremental picture, right? So I start with Vs. There is Rs. There is C1, which we will eventually assume as being a short circuit. What happens to Ra and Rb? This becomes Ra parallel Rb. Good. Your transistor is now a voltage controlled current source, where the current flowing is Gm times Vgs. And here you have RL parallel RL1. Is this fine? What is wrong? Right? This is floating. Your current source has been open circuited. There is no path for the current to flow, which means no current is going to flow. Right? So how do we solve this problem? The problem is happening all because of this current source. Right? So either we have to replace it with some other component or provide an alternate path, a bypass path, right, for the current to flow. So I am looking at adding an alternate path like this, right, which means of course I am going to put some component here such that this component is not affecting our operating point calculation, but it has to provide a shot when I am looking at the incremental circuit. So what component should I add? A large capacitor. Now, if this capacitor is large enough, then it is simply going to be a short at the frequency of interest. Is that clear? So, if I assume that all the capacitors are large enough to be assumed as a short, now tell me the gain quickly. So, V out by V in is going to be equal to minus Gm times RL parallel RL1. What are the assumptions we have made in saying this? RA parallel RB is much, much larger than RS. And of course, all the capacitors are large enough at the frequency of interest to be considered as a short. Okay. Now, of course, the next question to ask is, how large should C3 be? So I will leave the calculation for C1 and C2 to you. I presume that you are very familiar with these calculations now. Let's quickly look at how to calculate C3 again. So again, technically when I look at this, I have three capacitors. There is C1. There is C2 and then I have C3. If I try to estimate what the Thevenin impedance across C3 is, keeping C1 and C2, it's going to get very complicated. So much like how when number of villains come to attack a hero in the movie, the hero says, wait, come one by one. We'll say the same thing to the problem in front of us. We are going to break it down into small things and attack it one by one. So in our case, what is the smart approximation we are going to make? We'll assume that C1 and C2 have been designed to be large enough such that they can be assumed to be a short. Right? Then we look at the capacitor C3. We say that it has been connected between some node A and ground. Right? Now our problem simplifies to identifying what is the Thevenin resistance between the nodes A and B. Then eventually when we connect our capacitor C3 there, I simply have to make sure that impedance of C3 is much, much smaller than RTH. Okay. So let us quickly do the calculation for Thevenin resistance at this node. How do I proceed? So I remove C3 and I connect a test voltage between A and B. right? So this is connected to ground. This is my V test. And out of the V test comes some current I test. Right? What are the changes should I make to the circuit?
Yes.
So all the voltage sources have to be de-energized. So voltage sources being de-energized means that you tend them to zero. Current sources have to be open circuited. So this is now shorted. Okay. Now I am interested in simply V test by I test. Quickly tell me the node potential here. At the gate, it is zero, right? The same logic that we used earlier. If you assume that this potential is positive, then you'll have currents flowing like this, right? KCL is violated. If you assume that this potential is negative, then you simply have two currents flowing into the node. Again, KCL is violated, which means the only possible solution is for that potential to be zero. So this node is at zero, okay? So what does that mean for the current through the transistor? Is the current zero?
No,
right? It is GM times VGS. Your VG gate voltage is zero. Source voltage is VTEST. Right? So the current flowing through the transistor in this direction is minus GM times VTEST. So in other words, it is flowing up and the value of the current is simply GM times VTEST. Is that clear? Okay. If that is GM times V test, so all that you have is I test is equal to GM times V test. Right? Which means what is V test by I test? That is equal to 1 by GM. Right? This is dimensionally correct? It is dimensionally correct. Right? So this is actually a very interesting result. And also a very useful result to remember. Anytime you look up at the source of a transistor, the resistance that you are going to see is simply 1 by G. Okay? Now, I'll give this as a homework to you. Okay? Let's assume that you have a circuit like this. Say you have an RL here. Say that this is connected to some VG naught. I am interested in calculating the resistance looking up. Right? The only difference is lambda is not equal to zero, which means now you have to assume some RDS during your calculation. If lambda was equal to zero, looking up the resistance was equal to 1 by GM. Right? It did not matter what else was connected to the drain side. So now if lambda is not equal to zero, you have to calculate what this R is. Okay, but coming back to the problem at hand, why did we find out the resistance looking up? Because we wanted to estimate what the limit on C3 should be. Right? So what we have found now is this whole circuit can be simplified to 1 by GM. With some Thevenin voltage, which right now we are not interested in, and is connected to C3. Right? This was your node A and node B. So what is the condition on C3? C3 should be much, much greater than 1 by omega n into 1 by GM. Right? So this has to be much, much greater than GM by omega. So, any questions on this? Take a minute and see if you have any questions. Okay. So, now we have generated, we have done a constant current bias using two different methods. One method was this. The other method, again, looks very deceptively simple, but is this. right, where IRF was an ideal current source. So both of these circuits are a negative feedback. Now, on an IC, right, there is no limit on, there is no cost associated with increasing the number of transistors. You can use any number of transistors provided the area is reasonable, right? On an IC, you pay not for the number of transistors, but for the area that is being used. So you look at the area taken up by a particular component. That is why we would like to avoid inductors if possible, because inductors tend to take up a lot of area. But if you were building this on a on a breadboard using discrete components, then the cost of a transistor, cost of a current source, all of this will matter. Generally, passives are cheaper. So which means now we are looking at how we could replace this IRF with a passive component, right? Again, sometimes the even on an IC, you might be interested in replacing an IRF with a passive component. But for discrete circuits, this is often the case, right? So now we are interested in replacing this with some component such that the behavior of the circuit is still reasonably okay, right? We are looking for a Perlman substitute for a current source. So to this, to understand this, let me first refresh your memory about substitution theorem. Right? So let me consider some circuit. Let's say this is V1. You have some component here, maybe another component here. And a circuit like this, right? Maybe I can add a current source here. Let's say that is I0. Let's say the voltage across this component is V2. Some current I2 is flowing through this. Voltage across this is some V3. A current I3 is flowing. Let's say this has a voltage V4 and a current I4 is flowing. So all the branch currents, so this will be equal to I2. This I3 has to be equal to I0, right? And the potential here has to be equal to, is it V3 plus V4? V4 minus V3. It should be equal to V4 minus V3. So all the potentials, all the node potentials and the branch currents are clearly defined. Okay. So now very quietly, I replace this with a voltage source of value V2. Right. So this portion of the circuit has changed. Has anything else changed in the circuit? The node potentials have not been affected. The branch currents have not been affected. Right? If the node potentials are not changed, that means if this is still seeing V3, if this is still seeing V3 and it has a particular IV relationship, I3 is still going to flow through. Right? So even though I replaced a component with a voltage source, the rest of the circuit is not affected and the node potentials and the branch currents are remaining the same. Is that clear? Now let's say instead of replacing this with a voltage source, I replaced it with some I2. Any changes? So I replaced it with some current I2. The currents have not changed at all, right? Which means the node potentials will also not change. Is there a confusion on that? As far as the rest of the circuit is concerned, nothing has changed, right? Therefore, the current through this will be I2 because we put a current source I2, and the voltage across this has to be same as before because only then KVL and KCL will be satisfied. Right? So this is substitution theorem. Okay. So now let's say I took a current source here, right? This is a current source. The voltage across this is V2. The current through this is some I2. Is this current source dissipating power or generating power? Dissipating, right? If you have a terminal like, if you have a component like this, if the potential is like this and the current is flowing in this direction, then it is dissipating power. If it is dissipating power, I could replace it with a resistor of value V2 by I2. and nothing will change in the circuit. Now, this value of resistance is very specific to that circuit for the given potentials. If I change some other potential and I still want it to look like the same element, I'll have to recalculate the value of R. But for a given circuit with branch currents and node potentials, I could replace an I2 like this. Now, this is much easier if our current source is dissipating power, because that would mean that the R2 value is a positive value. It's a positive resistance. Right? If the I2 was generating power, for example, if the potential was in the opposite direction, which means now I2 is generating power, which means my R2 has to be a negative value. Right? A negative resistance is not easy to realize. So, if you had a current source which is dissipating power, I could replace it with an equivalent resistor. Right? Is that argument fine? Any confusions on this argument? Is it okay? Okay. So, if you have doubts on this, please ask questions either now or at the end of the class. It will be much easier if you ask now. Right? Okay. So, anyways, now tell me, is this IRF source here, is it generating or dissipating power? So, you would connect this to some VDD. Right, and typically you would expect the potential drop to be in this format, unless you are building up some very fancy circuit, right? So you would expect your potential drop like this, to be like this, which means now this current source is dissipating power, right? Now you know what the potential here is going to be. If IRF is flowing through this, it has to be some VGS0 given by VTH plus root of 2ID by mu NCO XW by L. So you know the potential here is some VGS0. You know the potential here is VDD, right? And you know a current IRF has to flow through this component, which means now I could replace it with a resistor of value. Correct. So I can replace it with a resistor given by VDD minus VGS0 divided by IRF. Right? So I'll simply write it as some RX. I've replaced it with some RX. So, by the same token, I could replace this resistor, this current source by another RX. Is that okay? So, like I said, resistor is our favorite substitute actor. Like how in, you know, big theater groups, you will always have people who act as substitute actors. If the main actor or actress falls sick, you put them in makeup and then put them in costume and send them out. So, RX or a resistor is our favorite substitute actor. So, now let me quickly compare three configurations. So, what we have done now is you initially had a circuit with IRF and a diode connected transistor like this. Right? We have replaced this with RX. And you still have the diode connected transistor. Let me also bring the scenario of directly feeding a VG0 to this node with RX connected here. Okay. Do you think these two circuits are identical, or what difference do you expect to see between these two? The theory that I presented before you is fine, right? I replaced IRF with another value of RX such that the behavior is identical, right? But are they equal in all sense, or what difference do you expect to see? Incremental model is different, right? So what effect do you expect to see because of this in the biasing? What do you think will happen if the VTH of the transistor increases? If VTH increases, you know for sure that the current through this is still going to remain same, right? Will the current through this remain as IRF, or is it going to be something else? There is a chance that it might change, right? Now, if VTH increases, again, we know that the current through this is going to change, right? So now, of course, This one looks like it is between option A and option C, right? But we would still like to verify how well or what constraints we should do for Rx such that this becomes more closer to A than to C, right? So let me give you a thought experiment to consider. Let's say your VTH has now become whatever was the earlier VTH plus a small incremental change of delta VTH. Right? I want to analyze this circuit. How do you recommend that I model this? So, did you follow that? We know that our current is proportional to, assuming that they have been biased in saturation, current is going to be proportional to VGS minus VTH the whole square. Right? So now my VTH has become VTH plus delta VTH. Right? Now I could bring this VTH associated with VGS. Right? All that I'm doing is I'm saying that I can treat it as VGS minus delta VTH minus VTH the whole square. Right? In other words, I can model this change in VTH as an input, as a small signal input. Is that clear? I know that VGS minus VTH is changing, which is going to change a current. So instead of just seeing an IRF, I could possibly see an IRF plus a small signal current. And I want to know how much this variation is. Okay? So one way to model is, I could model this change in VTH of the transistor as an incremental input to the circuit. Okay? So now, this VGS, I can again write it as VG minus VS minus VTH minus delta VTH the whole square. Right? Given this circuit, would you want to combine this small signal to the source or to the gate? Source looks easier, right? So, I would add a small VTH here. Again, the same small VTH is added here. And the small VTH source is added here. Is this clear what I have done? All that I have done is, this is VG minus VS plus the small change in VTH minus VTH the whole square. Right? I have simply added the change in VTH, I have modeled the change in VTH as an incremental fluctuation at the source potential. Okay? So now what I want you to do is, the moment I add a delta VTH, I would expect to see a small signal current. Right? So, originally I expected to see IRF. Now, I expect to see a small signal current ID. For three cases, can you quickly calculate what the value of ID is? Let everyone calculate and then we will discuss. So, you'll have to sketch the incremental circuit and find out what the small signal fluctuation in current is. How can I replace a diode connector transistor? This is 1 by GM. And then you have delta VTH. So what is a small signal current ID? Equal to 0. Right? This is the ideal scenario that we expected to see. Again, I can replace the diode connector transistor as a resistor of value 1 by Gm. So the small signal current ID will be equal to simply delta VTH divided by Rx plus 1 by Gm. So this Rx this node is connected to ground. Okay. If this node is delta VTH, what is the current flowing through this? Current in the opposite direction would be, so now in upward direction you'll have a current Gm times delta VTH flowing. Okay. So your ID is simply Gm times delta VTH. Or I can write it as delta VTH by 1 by G. Right? So we have calculated ID for all three cases. So as expected, the ideal situation we would like to have corresponds to having a current source of IRF. Right? Now, between having an RX and having an RX without a diode connected transistor, which of them do you think is a larger current? Right, this is going to be a larger current, right? And if we wanted our RX to look more and more like a current source, based on this, can you tell me what the condition should be? If RX was behaving like an ideal current source, the change in current or the incremental ID would have been zero, right? So we want to make sure that incremental ID is as small as it can get. If so, what should happen to Rx? Rx has to be very large, I understand, right? But how large is very large for us? This has to be much, much greater than 1 by G, right? Do you see the condition? So now among the three configurations, if you can use a current source, well and good. If you don't have the budget to include the current source for whatever reason, then a resistor is your best friend. Just make sure that the resistance value that you choose is much, much larger than the GM of the 1 by GM of the transistor. Is that clear? And are you also able to appreciate how we modeled a fluctuation in the transistor property as a small signal to the circuit so that we could analyze the three configurations? If there are any questions, please ask. Okay, so let me also quickly look at the circuit. Yes. So Rx has to be very, very large is one condition, right? And typically based on, so these are the two conditions that you have, right? So you are usually not hell-bent on a particular reference current, right? It is a design problem. So you will have to choose your Rx such that Rx is much, much greater than 1 by Gm so that the relationship is sort of like a ideal current source. Now on top of that, you will also need to choose either your VDD and the transistor size W by L such that VDD minus VGS0 by RF is giving you a particular resistance. So you have a lot of design variables to play with, right? And you choose, you optimize all of them together such that you are able to meet both constraints. So now, let me take this circuit. Can you quickly tell me how I should bias it such that I can also get an amplification out of this? So I need to bias it and add the small signal source. Let's say this was Rx. I generate VG0 from VDD. RA, RB. Then I connect my small signal source here. I connect the load here. Is it working? Is that a problem? Yes. You need another resistor here, otherwise there is no gain. Output goes to zero. And bypass the? Yeah, I have to bypass the resistor using another capacitor C3. Right? Now let's say for a minute, the C3 is not there. Right? Can you calculate the gain from Vout to Vn? So this is your Vn, Vout. Calculate what is Vout by Vn in the absence of C3. Start by sketching the incremental circuit and then analyze the circuit. So the voltage on the gate side is Vin, right? Let's assume that there is some voltage on the source side given by Vs. Let's say I've switched the notations. Vs now represents the voltage on the source of the transistor, right? Then what is the current flowing through Rx? So that is given by Gm times Vin minus Vs. That is also equal to Vs by Rx. Can you give me an expression for Vs then? So Vin Rx 1 plus Gm Rx. Is this correct? Right. So one quick test when you see an equation like this is to check for the dimensions. Right? You would have expected, because this is voltage, RHS also has to be a voltage, right? So this is already voltage, which means this has to be dimensionless. On the numerator, you have the dimension of resistor. On the denominator, it is dimensionless. So something is wrong with this equation. Just by, you can say that just by looking at the equation, right? So thanks for giving an incorrect equation so that we can test out this theory. Okay. So this is Gm Rx divided by 1 plus Gm Rx, okay, which means what is the drain current ID? That will be Gm by, so this is your Vs, right? Drain current is same as Vs by Rx, right? So it is Gm by 1 plus Gm Rx into Vn, right? So earlier when your source was grounded, your drain current was simply Gm times Vn, right? Now the source is also free to move. It can incrementally move, which means you see a different drain current given by Gm by 1 plus Gm Rx Vn. Is this drain current larger or smaller than before? It is smaller, right? Okay. So given the drain current, now you can quickly tell me what is Vout? So that will be equal to simply this drain current into the total resistance at the output. Okay. So this is equal to minus Gm by 1 plus Gm Rx into RL parallel RL. Okay. Now if I make my Rx much much larger than 1 by Gm, what comment can you make? Listen to me. Right? Then this simply becomes minus RL parallel RL1 divided by RX into V. Right? So your gain, earlier your gain was simply some GM times the equivalent load resistance. Now the gain is a ratio of two resistances. Right? So if you wish to have, and this gain is expected to be very linear. Unlike the earlier case where GM could vary with changes in mu and COX, etc., the ratio of resistance, you can make sure that it is a constant. You will not be able to guarantee that the resistance value is a particular value. It might change, but the ratios are well controlled on an IC. So ratio of resistance is something that you can nicely control. So if you make your Rx much, much greater than 1 by GM and you use a configuration like this without bypassing the Rx, then your gain is given by ratio of the output load, total resistance at the output divided by Rx. Right? Now, do you think this gain is going to be larger or smaller?
Smaller.
This will be a smaller gain. That's okay. So, next class onwards, we'll see about the other two possible configurations. So far we have done a drain feedback. The configuration that we discussed in today's class, sensing at the source and feeding it back to the source, this is called as a source feedback, right? And there are two more possible scenarios. We'll discuss that in the next class. Thank you.